Hello and welcome to the year 2024 Afrocentric TV, My Community. I remain your host, Kolawole Akinmuyiwa. You know, this is that station that revolves around the Africans in diaspora, especially here in the Houston area, with, of course, coverage in the entire Texas and by virtual, we mean the world. Right? We bring you information, we're trying to change that narrative because it's hard for you to see where the main media will cover Africans in diaspora, you know, doing great things or doing positive things. It's always about the negative influence. However, we're here to make that change. And here we are at Afrocentric TV. Again, my name is Kolawole Akinmuyiwa. And today we will be talking about issues as it affects us here in the Houston area. When you talk about Houston, you know, Houston is so, so large. If you're from Nigeria, you'll understand this. If you're from Ghana, you'll understand this. Houston is so huge. The metro area covers from Conroe to the Woodlands to Rosenberg, of course, Galveston, Richmond, Katy, Cypress, Houston itself, and lots of counties in between. So we have today some of our brothers, the ones that are bold enough to take a bold step to, you know, put us on the seats at the table. And I can't but honor this gentleman that will be joining us today. But before I dive deep, I won't do too much introduction so you guys can hear from them yourselves, right? So the first gentleman joining us today is a gentleman I've known him. I think I know his wife, you know, his father-in-law. So I know some things about him. So it gladdens my heart to bring him on to the show today to talk about why he is running for a seat at the table. And we'll tell you what seat he's running for. So, and we need your support again. So I join me to welcome Mr. Dayo. Welcome to this studio today.
Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here.
You know, like I said earlier, there's it gladdens my heart to see our people. When I say our people, I mean Africans. It's not just about us though, but you know, but it's just a thing to see that, you know, people are, they are looking for the change we all anticipate.
That's right.
But if we don't have anyone to help us make that change at the table, I guess we will all just be followers, right?
Unfortunately.
So thank you for running.
It's a pleasure.
So tell us a brief. I know your full name is Dayo David. So let people that probably don't know anything about Mr. Dayo David, you know, can you do a brief introduction about yourself?
Sure. So as you've heard, my name is Dayo David. I'm a migrant. You know, I came here in the 1990s.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I wasn't even born
yet. Well, you know, so it's been quite a while. I went to school in Massachusetts. I went to University of Massachusetts.
UMass.
Yes, UMass. Have an accounting degree, a bachelor's in accounting, and went further, you know, to get my master's in accounting. And then I started working for one of the big four, you know, accounting firms. Yeah, as an auditor. So I was doing audit. And then, you know, I was, you know, challenged and persuaded to push further. I went to law school to become an attorney. So,
wait, hold on. From being an accountant to be a legal practitioner.
Correct. Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yes, absolutely.
A passion for it. Well, I see why education is a big deal in one of your issues. So, yeah.
Please, absolutely. Go ahead. Absolutely. So, you know, I'm married. I'm married with three kids, three lovely kids. And, you know, part of the community of Africans here. So I think in a nutshell, you know, that's much about me.
That's fantastic. You know, and I appreciate that. So what prompted you to say, I think enough is enough. We've had it all. We've had enough of this. I need to have a seat at the table to be able to correct, if I may use that word, correct some measures or set some things in line for, you know, what's going to happen, not just to migrants, but to humanity in general.
Absolutely.
Right? So why, what pushed you to say you want to run for office?
Right. So I'm not a politician. I've never delved into politics before. But I've been a concerned citizen just pretty much sitting on the sideline and complaining. And what I've discovered
is with most of us, right?
That's right. But complaining does not change anything.
Mm.
You know, we'll complain every 4 years, 2 years, and, you know, nothing changes. So, and I felt like I have no right to complain if I've not gotten involved, if I've not done my civic duty, you know, if I've not come and have a seat at the table and say, hey, you know, here are ideas, here are things, here are ways we can make things better. So that's one of the things that drove me into it. I moved down from Massachusetts, and there are serious agendas, especially when it comes to like literature, which is one of the number one things.
Oh yeah, we're coming back to that because I had to do a little read up on you and
right.
on you know your agenda.
That's
you know,
right.
You have mm-hmm. pointers that one of which is that. So we'll still come back to that.
Okay.
Because it's. People need to understand mm-hmm. why you chose to run and
Absolutely.
What you stand to achieve while right. in office. And this is saying by God's grace, you getting into office, right?
That's right.
So you just highlighted why you're running and who you are. But you chose a unique party to run in Texas. I right. like, so when I say I like things, it's not right. about, you know, because I'm confused. I'm convinced now that I don't have to. I probably shouldn't say this, but I just strongly believe in what drives a man, as opposed to everybody saying no because it's off this or it's off that. The best help I've gotten in America was from a white man in Huntsville. When I say someone trusted me, so it's not about race, it's not about none of that. It's about who you as an individual,
That's
what
right.
do you have to bring to the table?
That's right.
And, you know, but you chose a unique party, like I said, a Republican Party to run.
Right.
Why the Republican Party?
Right. Thank you so much for that question. And that's one of the things I'm hoping our people will see, that they will first look at the individual and what agenda, what do they bring on the table? You know, what does the individual intend to do? And one of the things I'm running on, and if you dig deep, you actually find out that most of our people, if not all of our people, are very conservative. You know, they have conservative.
I agree with you.
Absolutely, they have conservative values, the way we were all raised up. So in pushing for one of my agenda, the only party really that can accommodate my position and where I can, you know, push this agenda is the Republican Party.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the agenda is the banning of gender modification in children. Even though there's a law that has already been passed, but there's some
in
pushback.
Texas, yeah.
Yeah, so there's no how I could go to other party, you know, and push that agenda. I'm going to be kicked out.
No, because they oppose you know? It, so I mean.
That's right. And, you know, I just feel like let children be children. You know, why do you have to inundate little innocent, you know, minds with those kinds of ideology? You know, when I was growing up, I was able to, I mean, we talked about the education aspect.
Mm.
You know, I had clear mind, I was able to focus and, you know, do what I need to do in school without someone saying, oh, you know, do you feel this way? You know, I have a daughter, one of my daughters, you know, she's about 11 now. When she was like 5'4", she wanted to be a pilot. At some point, she decided that she wanted to be an astronaut. You know, at some point, she decided...
She must love this space.
That's right. You know, can you imagine, like, if being a pilot was something you can just fix on a child and, you know, genetically, and then what happens? Now she wants to be, you know, an astronaut. What do you do? You know, so just keep children out of this matter and let's, you know, let them be children.
So it's one of the key issues that you have outlined on as part of your agenda, right? So which is going to, you know, I'm just going to go straight to it, you know.
Right. And that's why I'm in the Republican Party. That's one of the main reasons, you know,
we're going to talk about some more.
Absolutely.
We'll talk about some more.
Right.
So based on your agenda, and now I'd like for you to highlight what are those issues you think in Texas. And by the way, you're running for the state rep.
That's
right,
correct.
District 76.
District 76.
Correct. So we need to let people know that. So you guys, if you're out there, you cast your vote, cast your ballot for, of course, this gentleman here, Dio David, for you know, State Rep District 76. Don't forget that, Dio David. You can't miss it anyway. We have unique names of Africans, you know. So and then we're still gonna come back to talk about you know, if you're registered to vote, if you want to confirm that you're registered to vote. If you have not registered, you know, you need to get, you need to, you know, go ahead and register. And, you know, he will also let us know if you're eligible, you know, not if, but, you know, how you can confirm if you're eligible to vote, you know. So now coming back to this agenda, because it's the key point of why That's you're running. What are those issues you think here in Texas that we're facing, especially in your district?
Awesome. Thank you for that question. Well, I just highlighted the issue of gender modification. Mm-hmm. Do you know that Texas has the second highest human trafficking in the entire United States? Second highest. California is first. Texas is second. Right under our nose, you know, there are people getting trafficked, you know, here in this very
no state. Wonder we get that Amber Alert. A lot.
Yeah. You know, that's, you know, part of the reasons why we get that. But it's happening right under our nose. And, you know, I'm rising up to challenge the status quo. I'm rising up to support strong legislation that will severely punish those kind of activities. You know, there's no reason why, you know, I mean, we just celebrated Christmas. Mm. And while we are festiving, while we are in festivity, while we are eating and doing all that, there's a child being
abducted,
sex trafficked, child labor. Those are the two key reasons why they are, you know, why all this is happening. So that's one of my agendas, to fight and you know, combat sex trafficking in our cities.
So, and you also, which you touched on earlier, but I just wanted to, you know, expatiate on it. The gender reassignment for minors. So right. can you share your views on that for with us, please?
I know that's very strong.
Especially. Oh, it is very, very strong.
Right.
Africans. Yeah, please go ahead.
Especially with our community. You know, I was living in Massachusetts and I heard a situation of a father who went to school because the school had given the child like a material, and they talk about, you know, alternate family, and that it was okay, you know, for a child to have two fathers and all that living in the, you know, living in the house. And the father went to the school and said, "Hey, I appreciate what you're doing, but please, please, before you can give my child this kind of material, you need to get my permission to do so." And guess what the school did? They called the cops on him.
And on the father?
On the father, yeah. And they said,
I thought the law says a child is, you know, cannot make decision for themselves, the parent, until they turn, they become an adult.
Okay.
The parent have to make decisions for them.
That's a good point. But however, in Massachusetts, it's different. And that's why this office of a legislator is very critical, because they're the ones that make laws, you know, and that laws binds everyone. You know, binds your children, binds the family. So unfortunately, in that side of the world, it's actually absolutely okay. They have not broken any law. And that's what the school told the father, that we're not breaking any law. We're doing exactly what the law permits. And if we're not careful, I know that we're in Texas, but if you're not careful, if we don't rise up and stand and, you know, do something about it, we're going to have the situation we have in Massachusetts.
So, that's my
parents will have no say.
Because I know that they've taken God out of schools at some point, you know. You talked about education as part of your agenda, right? So can you shed a little more light on that education part of it? Okay. As it affects the family, as it affects the children, and you know, the mindset of these children growing up, you know, right. What the role the school or the education system has to play on it.
Thank you. Our education system is broken and it needs to be fixed. A lot of parents are pulling out their kids from school anyway. But what I'm pushing for is first a strong public school system while giving parents a choice in deciding where their kids go to school. You know, so I'm supporting parents. I don't believe government should have the say over where a child goes to school. I think parents are in a position, and they are best in that position actually to decide where their kids go to school. So one of the things that I'm pushing for is that they should allow parents to decide. And essentially, they're paying taxes already. They live within the, they live within the area. So they're already paying ISD taxes. So why can't they have a say and say, hey, this is where I want my kids going to school? And because one of the things that does is that it fosters competition. When a school, and you know how the school operates now, is that you're zoned. You're pretty much zoned.
Of course, yeah. So because we're in this zone, right. you can't go to the school or the other.
So essentially, you don't have a choice. Like the school has a monopoly, you know, over you. So you can't say, hey, you know, I don't like what's going on.
Except you move out of that subdivision and move elsewhere.
Exactly. And that's what people do. They, you know, literally have to move out of town or move to a different place because of the children's school. Mm. But if parents have a choice as to where their children go to school, you know, first, one of the things they would do is that the school itself would sit up. You know, they don't feel like they have a complete monopoly over you.
You can imagine
if we have one Walmart in town and there are no other
stores. They can decide how much they want to sell to people.
There you go.
You know.
So that's one of the things we're seeing, that, you know, they don't really care, you know. So we want a situation whereby parents can make choices, and we are very strong that will actually help the school. It will better the standard of the school when they see that, hey, you know, it's not just them dictating. Now parents have a say, and if they want to keep things going, then they will have to sit up. So that's one of the things we're pushing. The quality of education everywhere really has really gone down because, you know, the school system is not being challenged, and we're not bringing out the best out of the school system.
And if you look at the people the system is using to actually effect all these ideologies in the minds of these children, they are mostly people that probably don't have children of their own.
Unfortunately.
You know, so but then you want to be able to decide how... Wow. Parents, people that not just have kids, but are able to make children, work hard just to keep their children in school, and you know, still provide for these children. You still want to be able to make the decision over them.
That's right.
I don't think that's right either.
You know, absolutely.
That's one of the reasons why we have to get out there and vote.
That's right.
Do the needful. Then another thing that I have here is something. I'm also a real estate agent, right? So. Okay. And I've heard a lot of people this year, especially 2024, complain about the increments in their taxes, in their property taxes.
That's right.
What are you guys talking about? You know, I mean, wow, we pay so much.
I know, right?
The taxes. We pay high mortgage already, you know. So, and then these taxes just increase, and then the salary don't increase.
So, there you go.
Unfortunately, so.
That's right.
What are your views on that?
So, exactly right. You know, that's one of the issues that we are pushing for, that there should be a curb, you know, in taxes. So, essentially, if you think about it this way. The way they come up with those taxes is by appraising your property, you know, and every year the value of your property, you know, goes up. And as a result, it translates to the taxes that you pay. And like you said,
so it's going to be based on the valuation.
That's right. And like you said, unfortunately, that doesn't mean an increase in paycheck for most of the people. I mean, you know, the salaries stay the same, but now the tax bills are going up. So one of the things we're pushing is to curb the increment in the tax valuation, you know, to peg it at a certain rate such that our taxes don't keep going up. You know, that doesn't affect the fair market value of the property.
Or the property itself, because I was going to come back to that. Like, hey,
right. So this is just the tax. Yeah, this is just the tax side. But the fair market value, you know, still stays the same. I mean, essentially,
because if you look at some things also, which I love that point that you just made. There's so much you can pay, even if it's going to be late fee or anything like that, right? It's capped. Maybe after a certain period, after you've paid taxes up onto this for the value mm. of the property that you have. If you've paid your taxes up to this, then it's capped. Mm. Continue to pay that for the rest of, you know.
Exactly.
And maybe that should be considered. Right. Not that I'm telling you what to tell them. Well, I'm just saying these are our own concerns as citizens, right. You know?
Absolutely. And definitely that's one of the things that we're looking to push, you know, to have it capped. Because, I mean, if you look at real estate today, you see that a lot of the prices, you know, the cost of the homes have doubled, you know, and sometimes even tripled. So can you imagine, you know, you bought a house at maybe, say, 200. Now you're paying about 400, you know, over 400 because of the increment. Mm. So we want it capped, but it does not affect the market value of the property. Yeah.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. So with all of this coming together, what are your views on the mental health and physical well-being of the people, you know, that has been affected? Like, as a parent, you know, I'm a father of four. I see all of these things. We try everything possible to educate our children at home, tell them, you know, this is how, you know. And another thing is, children mostly do what they see their parents do for the most part. You can tell them this, and a lot of no's usually result to them wanting to try it out. So, and this plays a whole lot of role. People that are going to work all day, they're back home tired. They only spend a few hours with these children before they go to bed. And over the weekend, they start seeing, you know, differences in the behavior of the children. School system affects them. The community affects them, absolutely. You know. The churches, the mosque, and anything religious organization affects them and all that. So now they are thinking, what's going on? They don't trust the future anymore. Mm. What are your views on the position of parents and, of course, the children and the community at large, you know, and the mental health and the well-being of people?
That's a good question. Thank you so much. Actually, when I was in college, you know, one of the areas and one of the industry, if I can put it like that, where I worked a lot was in the area of mental health, you know. Yeah, I firsthand, you know, worked with people with developmental disabilities, worked with some of the elderly, you know, and the like. So it's a serious challenge, a serious concern, you know. There's a word that says train of a child in the way it should go, and when it grows up, it will not depart from it. So I know that in this nation, you know, parents have to work. You know, sometimes parents have two jobs, and unfortunately, it meant that the children are getting the short change, you know, that, you know, and, you know, many times they are working to really help the kids. But if they are not careful, especially with all the agendas that we have, agendas in school, as we talked about, they may have money and
they'll lose their children.
Unfortunately,
family, yeah.
Yeah, it's like you have wealth, but you've lost health, you know, the healthiness of your family, healthiness of your children. So I really encourage, you know, parents, you know, not to lose their guard, you know, especially now and with what's going on in our nation. And with all the agendas, you know, when it comes to their children.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Guys, that's Mr. Pastor Dyer David. And he's running for the state representative, District 76 in Texas, right? So you heard his agenda, you heard the issues facing us and how he plans to tackle them and his position on these issues. But please, if you have not already done so, please register to vote. You know, early voting starts February 20th. You know, and the last day for early voting, of course, is March 1st. And the main event, you know, the D-Day, the primary election, is going to be March 5. Please register to vote if you have not already done so. And you can also update your voters registration. And also check if you are registered to vote or eligible to vote. Where to do that in Texas would be www.votetexas.org.
G-O-V.
Oh, .gov, I apologize. So .gov because it's a .gov, right? I said .gov. Look at me. So votetexas.gov. And his district covers the Richmond area, the Sugarland, Stafford, Four Corners, Mission Bend,
Missouri City.
Missouri City.
Some part of Houston.
So guys, if you're out there, please get out and support. You know, if it's ideology about all of these things, you know, resonate with what you think the government of today should be like, please get out there. His name again is Pastor Dayo Davis, running for State Rep, District 76. Any word for people watching us right now that you want them to know about you and why they should support you?
Thank you. So, well, you've heard me, and, you know, I want to call you out to vote, you know, especially our brothers and sisters. Do you know, actually, that Houston and Texas in general has the largest population of Nigerians outside of Nigeria?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But yet there's not a single state rep, you know, in the House. Not a single state rep.
We did in other states. So.
Yeah, in Atlanta, but not in Texas.
Yeah.
Not
Tennessee, Atlanta, I think, yeah.
That's right. Not a single state rep here in Texas. But beyond that, the issues are real. The issues are issues that affect us all, as highlighted, the issue, you know, to ban gender modification in children. You know, as said, there's a law that has been passed already, but being challenged, you know, at the same time. So if these issues resonate with you, I want to encourage you to come out. You have the date, February 20th is the early voting, and March 5th is the election day. So I would just encourage you to support me, Dario David. It's going to be on the ballot. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
And he's going to need your help. You know,
yes.
He needs volunteers. He needs you to donate towards the campaign.
That's right.
And to do so, you can definitely get to is it Dario David
for Texas
dot com. Dot com.
Yeah.
Right. Dario David for Texas dot com. Yeah, right. And you can definitely reach out to the campaign team at 832-836-0246 or email DarioDavid4HD76@gmail.com. Guys, do us proud. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you. Christmas. Thank you so much. I appreciate
All right. it. Please do not touch the dial. We will be right back.
Thank you.
All right. Hello and welcome back to my community on Afrocentric TV. I remain your host, Kolawole Akinmuyiwa. And you know, this is that station that revolves around the Africans in diaspora. You know, like as I mentioned earlier, we are live here in the Houston area, but of course our coverage is not limited to Texas alone or Houston alone. You know, it's a technological world, and so we're all over the world, you know, via YouTube and stuff. But if you will remember that I mentioned earlier that, you know, I love when my brothers or sisters take bold steps to doing stuff, not just because of themselves, but, you know, to effect a change that we've longed for. It's something, if they don't see that in us, I'm sure they won't run for this office. They saw that, you know, we are crying for it, we're yearning for it. And so they took the bold step to say, you know what, if nobody's going to do it, we will do it. Joining us on this second segment is my brother, because, I mean, I've followed this man. You would think I'm his campaign manager sometimes, like the way I do it, but, you know, again, ideology, like I said earlier, it's about that person. What does that person have to offer? And it's not about, you know, you being in a particular party or not. But on this note, I will introduce to you our brother, Mr. Kenneth Omari. Welcome.
Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Ken, I've seen you from the beginning when you started this campaign up until now. And I can almost say you are already accepted. Because anywhere you go in Houston area now, I'm not even talking about yesterday, you know, like I said, I was I'm a real estate agent. I was somewhere near the Meadville area, Rosenberg, and I'm looking at this is Ken's campaign, this thing, and I loved it. The fact that, you know, you're everywhere now, people need to understand why you're running. I do, and that's one of the reasons why I said, you know what, why don't we let others know about this, you know? And thank you for taking that bold step to say, you know, this is a campaign that I need to do this.
Absolutely.
I need to do this. So, but, you know, for introduction sake, or for introductory sake, let's have you talk about who Kenneth Omari is.
Well, first of all, I'm really grateful for the opportunity to sit here. I can tell you Afrocentric Media is one of the bright lights in our community.
Thank you.
There are so many, if you put your ears out there, negativity within, you know, the minds of people when they think about Africans or Nigerians. Changing that narrative is not going to be overnight. And Afrocentric Media is one of those that are championing, taking that head on. So thank you guys for what you're doing and for this opportunity. Kenneth Omari is a young African Nigerian immigrant.
Please, when you say young, add the vibrant to it. Say young and vibrant. I mean, come on.
Thank you for your...
It is what it is. You know, we have to say it as it is, right?
I agree with you, Kola. Yes, a young and very vibrant young man who is running for a seat in the United States Congress. It is so surreal to me that I can sit here and tell you that I'm running for a seat in the United States Congress. Only in America will a child of a nobody become somebody without knowing anybody.
I agree. Without knowing anybody.
Yes. I like most immigrants, came to this country with nothing. The quest to come into America is a dream. And I say it like this. There are billions of people from every corner of the world that rely on America as the last beacon of hope.
I agree.
So when people come here and some others who are probably not understanding of the trajectory of coming to this country, they ask, why do you come to America? One word, the American dream. We all want to live the American
dream. That's right.
That's a summary.
It does not matter where anybody is. The last result I can tell you is the United States of America.
Absolutely.
Everybody knows that.
Absolutely. This country is the greatest country in the world. There's no question about that in the minds of everybody.
I agree.
So, well, I came here to this country in search of the American dream. And I am so grateful for the opportunity that I have had in this country to be able to come here and now live the American dream, being propelled by that same American dream to give back, to create more access for people who are like me, who are dreaming to live the American dream, to have that opportunity for them to live the American dream. That's...
Love it. You're a father. You're a husband. Maybe the husband should come first. You're a husband. You're a father.
Yes.
And you play the instrument.
Correct.
Sax.
The alto sax, yes.
Yes. And you are very well known amongst the Africans here in the Houston area.
Thank you.
But you chose to run. You know, within our community where everybody is, you know, holding back their tongue because they have so much to say, but we all can't sit, you know, on the bench, just warming the bench or be behind the computer and just type in nonsense like we always do. Everybody is always a critique when they come behind the computer. But you felt like, you know, there has to be something done and you want to do it. You want to effect that change. May I ask, why is it that you chose to run at this point in time?
Well, I'll come back to this question. Let me quickly piggyback on the point you made. I can tell you one thing for sure. As someone who I consider myself somewhat out there in that I teach, I'm a college educator. That's probably one thing I should have mentioned. Nigerians or Africans are some of the brightest in this country.
Oh,
there's no
doubt
question
about that.
From medicine to healthcare to education to sports to technology, we stand out. We have very good credentials out there. Having said that, running for a public office is just something that has not been a part of that community. And we wanting to run for a public office is not something that I wouldn't say it might be new, but I don't think they look at our community or the Nigerian community as a community that, you know, is laissez faire in other areas, like that it's not known or that we have. Mm. We just need to show more interest in this area. And I'm running not mostly or not particularly to say that there's no one else in the community that could have run, but I have, you know, the interest to be able to bring some of those things that we have learned from our background. I'm not a politician, like, you know, I'm an accountant. I'm a certified public accountant. I'm a CPA. We want to bring some of those value that we have from the technical point of view. We are technocrats, considered as
technocrats. Right, right.
Bring those value to the table and contribute to how we can, you know, move this country forward.
So, but why the party you chose to run on, the Republican Party?
I tell people I'm not just running as a Republican, because if I am just running as a Republican, God forbid it doesn't work, then I can go and run as a Democrat.
Right. No,
I am a Republican. I am a conservative. This is two different things. I am a conservative because the values and our upbringing, our foundation aligns more with the Conservative Party.
Mm.
So that is who I am. It's not but it's not because of a platform.
Yeah, so I have to flip this over, guys. And it says, Kenneth Omori for U.S. Congress, Congressional District 7. And this, it gets interesting here. This is why I pulled this up just so you can see. It says, he's an American by choice, right? Because he could have chosen to go to the U.K. or to Canada or to remain in Nigeria or even Algeria for all you care. But he said he's a conservative. By conviction.
That's correct.
That's deep.
Yes.
So you're convicted within yourself, like, you know what? I am a Republican and I'm running as a Republican. And there are some narratives that needs to be changed. There are some things that
I agree with you, Kola. That's absolutely
your ideology. So why should anyone elect Kenneth Omori into office, to the congressional office? That District 7,
correct,
right?
Yes.
So what are those issues that you think we're facing? Because I have some of them listed here, right? But I would love for you to give us a point on right. some of them.
And I tell you the truth, to the ordinary man on the street, a lot of people care less really about who, a lot of people care less about who occupies the sitting government.
Mm.
They just want to be able to provide for their family.
I agree.
Want to be able to go to the gas station and have you know, and not break the bank. They want to be able to go to the grocery.
Tell me about
that's
it.
That's the majority of people just want to live their life. So why am I running? Beyond the party, I think it's time for us to look at the credential, look at the credibility, and look at the ability, the quality of the candidate who is running, and their background, their profile. What have they done? What is their trajectory, you know, what is their understanding about how to fix things? I'm going to throw a perspective into this.
Please.
There's a lot of question about how the debt ceiling in this country keep going up. Recently, American total debt profile went beyond $33 trillion. And let me put that into perspective. Let me put that into perspective. There are about 330, there are about a million people in America. If you divide that number by the amount of people in America, an average person, one person in America will be owing over 90-something thousand dollars. The average household...
I don't have 90-something thousand.
Thank you. That was where I was going. The average household in America don't even make 90-something thousand dollars. So this debt ceiling, or this debt that is being, that we're mortgaging our future into, are going to be paid by not just us, our children, our children's children. So if we don't step in and nip that in the bud and stop the reckless spending, we are not just going to pay for it, but the consequences will be meant on our children.
Mm.
And I asked a lot of people, do you know how many legislators are in the U.S. Legislative arm? So when I say legislative arm, both the upper house, Senate, and then the lower house, Congress, And this, I mean, the ones that are politically savvy, they will say yes. You know, there are 100 senators, two from every state, and about 435 congressmen. And the total of that is 535 legislators in total. And then I ask the follow-up question generally, do you know how many of them are accountants? For the most part, I don't expect everyone to know that. There are only four accountants. Out of 535 legislators, only four accountants.
They're mostly attorneys.
They are mostly attorneys. I think there should be a balance. People who understand the practicality of what it means to balance the budget should be part of that process. More of such people.
Because that's what affects the nation.
Thank you. People who, beyond the rhetoric, talk is cheap. The practice of accounting or the practice of balancing the budget, knowing and understanding, being able to explain what it means when you're taking more debt, what that means in practical terms, I think it's time for us to have more accountants in Congress.
As it is, you look at an attorney who probably know about the law, probably does not know too much about the tax law itself or tax codes or you know, the accounting aspect of things. And so they go ahead and hire someone they deem competent enough, right? Become their special assistant or advisor to now educate them on that.
Correct.
It is whatever that person tells them that they believe is the right thing. But, you know, being a certified public accountant yourself, you can say, no, this number is wrong, or this is right, this is wrong. Because I remember a scenario in government, of course, where I think it was the child of past president or something. They was talking about, okay, these numbers aren't right. He said, well, that's why we pay the accountant. That's what they told us, what we're saying. And you look at it like, so they present something to you and that's all you have to say. So if you do not have a mind of your own or knowledgeable enough to say, no, this is not how it should be. This is how it should be. And I think I'm just saying this to buttress your point, you know, because I buy into that opinion where there should be a balance. When there's law, bring in experts. We can all come together and say, you know, this is how it should be.
Correct.
Even when someone is giving you a feed that is almost correct, but it's not 100, you can't challenge it because you don't know.
Right?
Absolutely. So I appreciate you bringing that up. I never even thought about it, you know, from that perspective.
And thank you, Kola. So beyond that, they're myriad of, you know, the inflation today affects both the rich and the poor.
It doesn't matter who you are. It does not matter who you are.
I mean, the economy today is not the same as it was a couple of years ago. I think the average household spend about $800. I'm telling you, based on historical,
we spend more.
Beyond $800 2 years ago, what we're spending beyond that $800 today. So in other words, if your salary, for example, didn't get increased between 2 years ago,
it didn't get increased. If it got increased, it's probably 25 cents per hour.
$800 more today than they were about 2 years ago. So we need people who can contribute and create more policies that are geared towards helping to stem this wrong. We're moving in the wrong direction, economic-wise, and that we can go into this debate, but how do we fix the economy? How do we contribute the knowledge or the skill, the background, the value that we have to help stand that? And then how do we bring more jobs back to America? Nobody talks about job being exported today. But if you take a look at the data, more of the jobs that were done in this country years ago, they're no longer here. They've been exported out of this country.
Sourced.
Correct. So how do we bring, you know, create more jobs? How do we make more people to work? COVID changed a lot of things.
It did.
The world is a global village.
It was.
I agree.
Mm-hmm. It still is, rather.
Correct. There are pros and cons to every situation. But how do we make the best of it so that the people, the Americans who are hurting right now from this inflation, from the economy, can. And then I'm an accountant. I want to also help to reduce the taxes.
I was going to talk about that. Because, I mean, that affects nearly everybody. So my wife's cousin, first cousin, he lives in a house somewhere in Texas. And then he called me the other day and he said, hey, Kola, I know you're a realtor. I think I'm being gentrified. I'm like, what do you mean you've been gentrified? He said, yeah, because all of a sudden my property tax No, the value of our property, they just added $500,000 to. I'm like, that's huge. Yeah, he lives in a premium area, right? So, and they're like, so, and I said, what have you done about it? Have you trying to see, you know, have you called your CPA? Have you called an attorney? Have you trying to call, you know, the county itself to see what the issue is? He said, yeah, I do. But they said, yeah, it's correct. Okay, do you have neighbors? Can you, that you talk to, you can relate with them, see if that affects them also? And lo and behold, the whole neighborhood was affected. Mm. So he felt like, so, and in my head, I'm thinking, oh, this is going to affect everybody. And already, we're already seeing the tax increment, right? So what are you guys doing, well, going to do? Because in my head, you're already in that
city. Amen.
And that's speaking prophetically. Amen. And faithfully, right? So what do you think is happening, and how do we combat that?
So thank you so much for that. And about a few, maybe more than 5 years ago, there was an introduction of what they call the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. It was meant to create some incentive, especially for certain areas of you know, the tax system in this country. One of the biggest tax cuts that happened was the corporate tax rate. America used to be one of the developed countries with the highest corporate tax rate in the world.
Mm.
So because of that, a lot of countries were taking headquarters from America, meaning if my tax rate here is very high, I would take my headquarters out of this country to a low taxing jurisdiction, so that there's what they call corporate inversion in tax, meaning you want to shift your profit to where have the lowest profit tax rate, so that you can pay overall your lowest, you pay lower tax bracket overall. So, but when Tax Cuts and Jobs Act was enacted, many companies brought back those their headquarters back in the U.S. because there was no need to do a corporate inversion anymore.
Mm.
The U.S. tax corporate tax rate was reduced to a flat rate of 21%, as against about 39% average. So that was just one aspect, the corporate tax rate. And then for individuals, there were some tax credits and some, you know, incentives and increases, you know, but some of these credits and some of these tax incentives, they were temporary for like a couple of years. And some of those credits, they've expired. Now, as an accountant, how do we make some of those credits permanent? So that the intention of the Tax Cut and Job Act that was enacted can be felt more on the long term, rather than just in the short term. So those are some of the policies that we're going to be looking at. Just beyond the Tax Cut and Job Act, we are going to be enacting policies that will help to reduce taxes and, you know, put more money in the pockets of Americans.
Let's talk about one thing that affects Africans so much, and is dear to them, if you ask me, immigration. What are your views on immigration today?
No, thank you so much. This is a very, very touchy area or point that everyone would want to know my point of view regarding immigration. And it's a very important thing I make a clear distinction here, because this platform, I don't know of any other platform that reach that have the wider reach to the African community like Afrocentric.
Thank you.
When they talk about when we talk about illegal immigration, a lot of people have no idea. Maybe I think in my own, from talking, engaging with people, understand what they understand by illegal immigration. Coming into this country legally is different from crossing the border and coming into this country undocumented. Those are two different things.
Mm.
If you came into this country and you got in a point of entry, you got checked in, you got stamped in, you know, your visa, you came into this country, you came here legally, it's a different thing entirely from someone who came in through the border undocumented. And these are some of the pros and cons of that, if there's any pro.
Right.
If someone who came into this country through the border undocumented commits a crime, more likely than not, he would not be traced. He's untraceable.
Yeah, untraceable. Because there's he has no documentation.
Correct. He has no fingerprint anywhere.
Mm.
So what ends up happening is that when these guys, or some of these bad guys, not all of them, some of these bad guys commit crime, people generalize them and say they are all illegals who are committing this crime. So I think I needed to make that distinction. And having said that...
So to create the generalization...
Correct. Having said that, today, more than 7 million people since the administration of this current
government
came in, more than 7 million people, which is approximately the size of Florida, have come into this country undocumented.
Wow.
That should concern anybody. And when I mean undocumented, came in through the border.
I mean, if anything happens, you can't trace it.
Thank you. So my question is, when people talk about immigration and they especially, and I'll put it out there, especially when there is a misconception about how the Republican Party view immigration, that I was at the event that, you know, we had recently, and someone took a flyer of mine and was talking to one of our volunteers and said, oh, he's running as a Republican. Republicans hate immigrants. And the person who she was talking to pulled me into that conversation. And I asked her, what did she just say? She said, what did she just say? She said, Republican Party hates immigrants. And I asked her, take a look at that picture again and repeat that. She took a look at it and said, I said the Republican Party hates immigrants. So, but the person in that picture is an immigrant. Say that again. So the point I'm trying to make in this is that there's a distinction between legal and illegal immigration.
And that's probably where the generalization comes into play, and it's not well defined. And thank you for breaking that down.
We need to educate our people. They need to know. The Republican Party don't hate immigrants. When we were in Nigeria, and I'll take your mind back a couple of probably years ago, right? There is a bag called Ghana Must Go Bag.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know why that bag was named Ghana Must Go Bag?
Because we're kicking Ghana out.
We're kicking Ghanaians out of it. There's a natural, if you have a house, you have a fence around your house. If you have a house, you sleep at night and you shut your door. The reason why you do that is so that people don't come in illegally. Do you send visitors out when they come in legally and they knock the door and come in? That's exactly what is being done from the Republican point of view. And I know there are so many people from our community that might not hold this view. It's not going to be overnight. It's going to take a long time to be able to systematically educate our community. But I stand before you not only as a fellow American, but as that young immigrant whose aspirations strike the same chord as the American dream. And I'm telling you this from my own experience. So far, my personal experience have negated the narrative that is out there that the Conservative Party hates immigrants. No, they don't hate immigrants. They are talking about illegal immigration. If you cross into the border undocumented, that is the problem. Because even in Nigeria, even in where we come from, no country in the world will allow people come in to the country without an idea of who these people are. Not to talk about America. America remains the melting point of people from every corner of the world. There is no country that is not represented in America. How would you turn and say the same America hate immigrants if the country itself was built on the idea of a free world? This country is the only country that is built on an idea. America is an idea. Unless, if someone tells me that I'm an immigrant, the question I ask them, so what do you mean I'm an immigrant? We are all immigrants. You're either
true.
A second generation American,
that is
third
true.
Generation, that fourth is generation. True. Unless you're an American Indian or the Native
American.
Yeah, we're all immigrants. America is a country of immigrants. So that's the truth. So never feel because you're an immigrant, you feel maligned. No, nobody should make you feel maligned. And I tell people, no American is more American than any American. We are all Americans.
You know, I like your passion for what you're doing. And guys, I would like to suggest to you to vote for Mr. Kenneth Omori. Mr. Kenneth is a Republican. He's an American by choice. And I'll repeat this because I love the quote right there. American by choice, but he's a conservative by conviction. He's running for U.S. Congress, Congressional District 7. And the Republican Party, of course, that's under the platform which he was running. Early voting starts February 20th. It ends March 1st. That's for early voting, right? And then the election date itself is March 5th, 2024. Mr. Omori has been endorsed. And I think I need to push this out there just so you know. He's not a baby Republican, or, you know, he has been endorsed. And this is where, you know, he has the support of people that are, I won't use the word that's coming to my mind because I think it's too deep, but, you know, prominent Estonians. And they feel like this is that man that we need to push our weight behind to help us in Congress. You know, you're talking about, you know, Mattress Mack, you know, Jim Mack, Texas Right to Life, Ray Hunt, Reverend Randy Meeks, Sam Malone, Congressman Tom Campbell, Douglas Griffith, Christian Collins, Philip Aronoff, and many other. And of course, his ideologies are to combat crime, secure the border, fix the immigration system, reduce taxes, that I want personally, and to curb the rapidly increasing cost of living. I want that too. My children are grown now. They eat. I need the saving grace, and I need this man. So we need to also restore our trust in our government, which is one of the reasons why he's running, right? And then defend against attacks on conservative values, which are some of the points that he highlighted. And, you know, we talk about healthcare, taxes, accountability and trust, attacks on conservative value, crimes, immigration. This is the most important part, especially as it affects Africans, other than the taxes and the cost of living, immigration for foreigners, given that America itself is built on the back of immigrants, right? So immigration is key, and his ideas. I mean, I learned so many things just talking to him today. I never knew, you know, the way he broke it down is different. When you say illegal immigrant, we all think it's because you've been in America, maybe your visa expired and you don't want to go back, maybe because something was happening in your country and you're afraid if you go back, you know, you might not get the same benefits as you're getting in America, whatnot. But people literally cross the border illegally. They're undocumented. And I came across a guy a long time ago. I'm sure that's been over 10, 15 years ago, where he was talking about he wanted to file for, I think he got married and he wanted to file for his citizenship for a green card, but he couldn't get the paperwork done because there was no documentation, there was no recognition of him being in the United States. So which is one of the reasons why I'm loving everything you have to, you know, you're working with. So Mr. Kenneth here will need your support. He will need you to be a volunteer. If you are able, please join his campaign team. And also he will need your donation. This does not run freely. You know, we have to print flyers, he has to do media, he has to travel, he has to do all of that. He needs money to do that. So if you feel this ideology resonate with what you believe or your beliefs, please donate towards his campaign. You can definitely reach them at kennethforcongress.com. kennethforcongress.com. Or you can call 832-626-3140. And you can email him, of course, at kenneth@kennethforcongress.com. Mr. Kenneth, thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate you. So for just 1 minute, I know our time is fast spent, but for 1 minute, I need you to tell our viewers, you know, why they should come out to vote for you.
Thank you again. I'm so grateful for this opportunity. I want to talk to you, my beloved community, our African community. For a very long time, our community have represented this country well, extremely well across various spheres of this economy. This is the first time a Nigerian is running for a seat in the United States Congress in the state of Texas. My appeal to you is to show that we have a community. We have a solid community in this country. When the Indians or the Asians, I'll call it, when they run, most of the time you see they come out for their community. We need your support. We can't do this alone. It's not about Kenneth Omorohie. My last name is still going to forever remain Omorohie. That's not going to change to Collins or Bush. We are doing this for our children. We are doing this for the future yet unborn, our children's children. So please come out. I know there's this rhetoric out there. Our African community, many of them will say they don't vote. But this time, let's make a difference. Come out and vote. February 20th, early voting, and March 1st, till March 1st. And then March 5th is the day of the voting for primaries. Come out and vote for Kenneth Omorohie for United States Congress, Texas 7th Congressional District. Thank you so much, and God bless this United States of America.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kenneth. And please do not touch the dial. I will be right back. Welcome back to my community on Afrocentric TV, channel 27.9. I remain your host. My name is Kolawole Akinmuyiwa. And today, I learned so many things, you know, on these two segments that we just had. Voting is one. If you're not registered to vote, please, this is that time you need to register to vote. It is your civic duty to do so. And if you have not, you please register. If you have already, just reconfirm, just to make sure, you know, your vote or your registration is still validated, or valid rather. Check if you're registered to vote, and you can do that here in Texas at www.votetexas.gov, votetexas.gov, right? And early voting starts February 20th and it ends March 1st. But the actual main event, the election date for, you know, the U.S. House of Rep and Congress here in the Houston area, definitely, and all the primaries, is March 5th. Please, this gentleman needs your support. Kenneth for Congress, and of course, David, Dio David for Texas.com. They both need your help. So they need your donations, they need you to volunteer, and they need to help campaign and support the movement. Let's do this for not just for the culture, but for humanity, for what they believe in, for what you believe in. And, you know, let's see how this is going to affect our lives positively moving forward. I vote for the tax cut. I vote for the immigration aspect of it. I vote for the cost of living. I vote for security, for the trust and accountability, for housing, for all of these things. So, and these are the people that I believe that I experience in their professional lives bringing it to legislation. So it is just not our duty to support, you know, our fellows doing this, but it is also our duty to change the narrative here in the diaspora. So I remain your host, Kolawole Akinmuyiwa, and thanks for joining me today. If you have not done this before, please follow us on social media. We are at Afrocentric TV, at Afrocentric, AFROCENTRIK TV. And that's on Instagram, and that's actually on Facebook as well. We can do Afrocentric Houston as well. K is at the end of the Afrocentric. And please like, subscribe, follow us, share our videos on YouTube.com, and that's Afrocentric Television, Afrocentric Television, two words, on YouTube. Until next time, please subscribe and stay out of trouble. We love you. Have a good day.